That was a real roast. And they had Walt Grealis, Jay Nelson, Stan Kulin, George Davies, Roger Ashley, who sounded so much younger on that tape. A next door neighbor of ours, plus Dr. Don Regan, the one and only Tom Brownlie. Also, Jerry Steele, Don Richmond, Bill McDonald, Ed Preston, Julian Breen, Leo Cahill, Tom Rivers, Bob Lane, Fred Sherratt, and Walt Grealis. Some of the stuff on those tapes is just fall down funny. Bob Lane in particular, Ed Preston unbelievably was very funny. I mean, this is just hilarious. And I have the tape. It's going to be too much of that kind of stuff, the roast from 30 years ago. But I am going to make that tape available somehow, either to each of you individually if you want it, or I'll put it on YouTube. But it's really funny. I was called to be inducted in the Canadian Hall of Fame. I decided I would accept, partly because I'm getting so old I might not have too many more chances, but mainly I had actually turned down two or three previous occasions where I had been approached about allowing my name to stand. First of all, I don't like public speaking, but secondly, it just didn't interest me and I had other things going on in my life. But on this occasion, it dawned on me that this was something that is important to recognize because we did it as a team. So I accepted, but I made it very clear to Neil Dixon, the organizer of the event, that I would accept, provided that it would be a chance to recognize our team. And he said, well, yeah, okay, well, let me know what you have in mind and we'll see what we can do. So I went to work on them, and I started off by saying, okay, well, I'd like to come up, and if you don't mind, then I'll start introducing people from the podium, from CHUM. No way. And part of the reason why they were very tight on their timing this time is that David Marsden apparently won the award about 3 years ago, and he talked for 35 minutes, and they were trying to get him off the stage, and he just kept talking. So that didn't leave a lot of room for the rest of us later. But in any event, I said, okay, well, if I can't introduce everybody who's there, why don't I bring up, say, you know, a half a dozen people who I think should be in the Hall of Fame themselves? And they thought about that for a while, and they said, oh, that's going to take too long. So then I said to him, okay, well, what if we, you know, maybe we do something different. Maybe, for example, we use the actual plaque that you're going to put it on and engrave the names of all the people who worked with us in the 70s on the back of the plaque. And he thought that could be okay, but he said, I'll put you in touch with Beryl Moss. So I contacted Beryl. Well, no, they just couldn't do that. And I said, well, Beryl, look, I said, it's just engraving names on the back of a plaque. I said, let me call around and see if I... So sure enough, I found somebody who could engrave all the names on the back of the plaque. Their plaque, however, wasn't ready to have anything done to it because it wasn't even constructed yet 3 days before the event. And I didn't bring the plaque with me. It's beautiful. I should have brought it, but I didn't. But I do want you to know that at some point, very soon after this event is over, we are going to have it engraved with the name of everybody who worked at CHUM in the 70s and the department in which they worked. So many of you will have your name on that plaque, and at some point at a future CHUM get-together, in fact, maybe even later today, you can see it as it is now, but the names on the plaque, you won't see until they're all done. However, we came up with another idea that I thought would help to recognize the team, and that is, I called them to find out what it would cost to post an ad in their program. And they said, well, a full-page ad would be $5,000, a color ad. And I said, okay, well, no, I didn't have that kind of money, but I know Jim Waters. So I said, well, what's it cost for a black and white ad? And they said, $2,500. I said, okay, I'll get back to you. So I called Jim, and as you know, Jim graciously agreed to pay for the extra tables, and he right away said, absolutely, he said, for sure. So we had the ad drawn up, and it's in the magazine, and I'm disappointed that I forgot to mention to everybody that there's a full-page ad in the Canadian Music Week magazine in which you are all mentioned, just as you would have been on the back of the trophy. So on your way back, if you drop by downstairs, get a copy of the program. I think they're free.
Yeah, they are.
And are they?
Yeah.
Oh, have you got a copy of the ad in here, Doug? Okay, so.
I tried to find it, I couldn't find it.
So.
Oh, you didn't see it in here?
No, I didn't know what, I didn't go through it.
Oh, okay. So.
Well, Paul Skier is saying he doesn't think it's there.
Really?
Did you look I went through page by page to see if I was in there anywhere. And
where are you?
Just kidding. Unfortunately, no, I didn't see. I could have missed it.
Oh, I see what's happened here. This is the magazine, I believe, that's associated with last night's awards. I think this is a different magazine that we're in.
There's another magazine. There's a
it's the one for music, though, I think, Chuck. Yeah. There's one for music, but then there's, I think there's a newspaper, too, or a newspaper type thing. So pretty bad. Yeah.
In any event,
if you paid for it.
I have the address for everyone here. It's a very dynamic ad, the way it ended up looking. I will send it to you, but I will certainly check it out to see whether or not they actually even published the ad, because they've already got Jim's money.
That's neat.
Yeah. Well, anyway, in addition to that, we want to make sure that we post the video that they did on YouTube, and that will be the unedited version of the video, where there are beautiful comments from many people, but also J.D. Roberts. Apparently he did a beautiful tribute, but the file got corrupted and they weren't able to use it. But it will go on to YouTube, and the main point in all of this is that at the end of the day, as I've said to people again and again, it said this in the ad, and it's going to be on the trophy itself. This really is something that was made possible because of all of you. We all worked together, shoulder to shoulder, and created some great radio. And that's why it was important to me to do this, because I really feel badly that there are so many people that put in Hall of Fame performances, but they're in positions that, in effect, are never recognized by the industry. The program directors get some recognition, or the managers, or the top DJs, but not the people who are, you know, in there with the rest of the team. So that's why this was so important to me to do, and why it's important that we have the ad and the trophy embellished that way, and that at some point we post it on YouTube, because there will be quite a piece in YouTube about the staff and their contributions. It won't just be the Bob Woods stuff, it'll be about all of you as well. And last but not least, and there's one other part of this I am trying to remember here in respect to the event itself. It's not the ad, it's not YouTube. I'm forgetting it here. Sorry, but I'm having a senior's moment. you remember what it was?
It's not the Lions, no, 3-3, right?
We have a problem.
Okay, so we posted the ad, the YouTube thing. Oh, I know what it was. In today's issue, if you have read it, maybe they didn't get it in today, but it was supposed to be in today, but if it's not today, it'll be in someday next week, is an interview that Warren Cosford did with me. And it's an interview in which I have a chance to recall the
issue of
today.
Of what?
Of FYI.
Oh.
Okay. And in today's FYI, there's about an 8 or 8.5 page interview there where I talk at length, not only about the early days of CHUM, but all of the wonderful people that we worked with. Most of you are referred to in that article in some way. So I hope you'll make it a point to check out the current edition of FYI, and if it didn't make it in today's issue, it'll be early next week. I will try to make sure that we get a copy of that out to you. in any event, even if you don't see it, along with the ad that I mentioned. But at the end of all of this long speech to make up for my shorter speech, I just wanted to say something I said earlier back at the hotel, that this day is really an emotional day for me, because it's a chance for my real family to meet my radio family. And so here you all are together. I'm really happy that you could all come and to be here. And now I'd like to turn the floor over to some of you individually who have great stories to tell. Hi, Vince, nice to see you. And I'm gonna start, maybe I'll introduce people as they come up, and I'll ask everybody to say a few words. You can tell a couple of your favorite war stories, whatever story you wanna tell. That would be fine with me. In fact, I might even give you an example of a war story I've told a few people in this room before.
You tell that one.
And this is back in the early 70s when CHUM used to own the C&E grandstand, and all the acts that would come in, we would get to present them. But when CFTR came along, they argued that it's a public facility and that they should be able to present some of the acts too. So my friend at the CNA, Howard Tate, called me and said, well, now what do we do? And I said, Howard, that's okay. I'll tell you which acts they can have, and we'll pick the rest. I said, probably the best act you could give them would be the Guess Who. And he said, okay, I'll give them the Guess Who. So CFTR had the Guess Who. So the night of the concert, and this is at the CNA grandstand, where the stage is kind of in front of like 30,000 people. And we made sure, it was dusk and the crowd was all in seated and waiting for the Guess Who to come out. And during the course of this get-together, we have all the CHUM models with their t-shirts on, streaming through the crowd, wearing CHUM t-shirts. And we had Mike Koenig, who was in promotion at the time, with the CHUM promotional cruisers, pull two cruisers right up in front of the stage with the 1050 CHUM call letters on the side of the car. And we had an airplane flying by, CHUM welcomes the Guess Who to Toronto. So that everybody would soon get the impression it was a CHUM concert, because it was a CFTR presentation. And in any event, Howard Tate came to me and he said, I'm getting a lot of heat here. If you don't get those cars out of here right now, I'm going to get them out of here with a forked truck. So I said, okay, fine. So I said to Howard, we've had a problem finding the keys, Howard, but I'll see what I can do. Anyway, we finally got the cars off the front of the stage. The lights went down. The CFTR announcer comes out on stage, and he says, ladies and gentlemen, CFTR is pleased and proud to present the Guess Who. And out comes streaming the Guess Who, strumming their guitars, wearing CHUM t-shirts.
I didn't hear last week.
Listen, they did it to us as much as we did it to them, but it was fun in those days. Anyway, I'm going to start off with one of the superstars we have here today, and his name is Mike Cooper. Mike has been the morning man at CHFI for a number of very successful years. And really, I think he was perfect for that show, because he kind of picked up on the folksy kind of quality that Don Dinger brought to the show. I'm not so sure they've got that now, but Mike certainly brought that. And I saw Mike a few years ago at one of these award dinners, and he came over, said hello to me, and he started talking about when I first interviewed him for a job, and he was nervous in the interview, so he may tell you about that, I don't know.
Yes.
But Mike and Roger Ashby were both morning men on CHUM, who started at CHUM on the CHUM All Night Show, and likewise Steve Elliott out in Vancouver. So for the last quite a number of years, we had former CHUM All Night Men doing morning shows at the biggest markets in the country. So Mike, it's your turn.
Thank you. You know, you don't get an opportunity to say thank you. And this is a perfect opportunity for me, because Bob...
Please stand up, Mike.
Bob, excuse me, I'm loud, but I don't like to be seen. But Bob hired me, and I was just a kid with long hair and a voice deeper than whale shit back in 1971 or 2. And I remember going into his office. Now, I was a huge CHUM fan. I'm from Hamilton, so I knew everything. Bob said, come for the interview. I sit there, and I don't know if you've ever noticed, but Bob used to, when he used to make me nervous, he would hold his hands together as if he was praying for the baby Jesus, you know, when he would talk to you, and he'd go, how old are you, Mike? And I went, why did he ask me that? Because actually it was this month, just before my birthday, I was 20 years old, and he said, how old are you? And I said, I thought you had to be 21 in order to work at CHUM. I swear to God, that's how young and stupid I was. And I said, I'm 21. And he said, well, how, when's your birthday? And I went, May 24th. And he said, what year? And I went, oh, Jesus, do I add a year? 1950. And he goes, you don't know how old you are? No, I got it. And he goes, what's your name again?
My name is Mike Cooper. The microphone.
That's live.
Oh,
like you always have done.
That made me nervous, the furry part, though. Sorry. So, sure enough, I didn't know I even got the gig. He leads me out of his office, and I don't know where we're going, but I think we're going out the door. So I'm not sure if I actually got the job, and he leads me into the jock lounge, and there were all the biggest names that I had ever listened to in radio. They were all there. Tom Rivers, John Gilbert, Jay Nelson, Terry Steele, Scott Carpenter, Jim Van Horn, all these wonderful names that I listened to for years and years and years. They were there, and I couldn't say a word because I was in a room of greatness. And Bob says, this is your new all-night guy. And I went, and so Tom Rivers says, are you any good? And I remember looking down at my feet and I went, I suck. In the light of what was happening in this room with all these great names and all this wonderful talent, no, I'm not very good at all. And Tom said, great answer. And they took me in, and I was accepted by that staff almost immediately. And he said, Bob said, this is our new all-night guy. His name is Mike Cooper. Just don't ask him how old he is. And that's the rest of the story. Thank you, Bob, for hiring me. It was a great hire, you got to admit it. Yeah. All right. You don't have to admit it. Who's next?
Mike, tell us another one. Tell us in particular, I'd love to hear it, the story about the marathon.
Oh, the Ferris wheel. Yeah. I'll make this very, very quick. We're in the jock lounge, and Bob says, I got a great promotion. We need somebody to ride a Ferris wheel for 21 days, 10 hours, and 10 minutes at the CNE. Who would like to do it? And my hand shot up, like, yes! But I noticed nobody else put their hand up, and they went, why didn't you put your hand up? And he said, well, okay, you're the all-night guy, but is there anybody else that would like to do this? Nobody put their hand up. And I said, why wouldn't anybody want to ride a Ferris wheel for 21 days, 10 hours, and 10 minutes at the CNE?
Break the Guinness World Book?
For the Guinness World Book of Records and be famous for the rest of your life. Nobody had their hand up, and that's when I got worried. I said, oh, what have I done? So sure enough, they put this seat in a Ferris wheel, and it's got a canopy. It's all made of tarp, and they put a pad. And I started to ride this Ferris wheel. The first day was dreadful. The second day was worse, and it just got worse and worse and worse. Sleeping, atrophy in my legs because you had to put your legs up, and then the blood would rush back into my. So finally, I said to Bob, I'm kind of hurting here just a little bit. He said, Mike, just two more weeks. Two more weeks. I think I can do it. 2 weeks into 2 weeks into it, Bob gets a call because I left the fairgrounds. In the middle of the night, I got beat up by three guys that was after a concert, I think it was in, I think it was a Guess Who concert. They decided they want, and they wanted to actually see if there was anybody inside this Ferris wheel seat. Now, it was during a thunderstorm, and it was the most terrifying thunderstorm, and I'm in a metal A-frame, you know. And one of the carny guys gave me this crescent wrench, which was about that big, and it's used to tighten the bolts on the A-frame. And he says, you might need this. It gets a little rough at night, and put it under my seat. So I said, well, yeah, but I think I'm going to be fine because I have a security guard, you know. Sure enough, these guys wanted to find out if I was inside, and they started rocking the seat back and forth during this thunderstorm, and it's all fogged up inside. And so I unzip. They kick me in the face, and I'm trying to get out. I'm desperate. I got to get out of this. And it opens from the outside, so I am trying to open it from the outside, and they're kicking my hand, and... Well, you know what? I'm in trouble. I'm in serious trouble. No security guard. I take out the crescent wrench, and I whack one of them. And boy, did I ever whack them. And then I take the crescent wrench, and I throw it up on top of a building, walk down the midway, and on Lakeshore, a cop pulls over and says, get in the car, son. And when he said son, it kind of... stopped me just for a moment. It was so much compassion, and because I was walking home. I lived on the Don Valley. I had no money, so I was walking home. And he said, "You're the guy from the Ferris wheel." I said, "Yeah." He said, "Get in the car, son." So I got in the car. Takes me back to the Ferris wheel, because I'm breaking the record, for God's sakes. I can't believe it. Takes me back, and I tell him the story. The guys are long gone, and there's Bob, and I remember Carol in her robes and curlers, and she gives me a big hug, like, you know, I'm one of her own. I remember that, and Bob wants to know what had happened, and I told him and everything else, and are you okay? Yeah, I'm all right. I had a black eye coming up, and so the cop said, well, where's the crescent wrench? And I went, what crescent wrench? Because you told me not to say anything about the crescent wrench. And he said, I saw the mark on the man's face, so yeah. So I said, it's on top of the building. And so the cop just took it, put it in his pocket, never heard from it ever again. I was charged with assault and battery. That's the part you probably don't know. But I got off. It was wonderful. And then Bob, God love him, put a cosmetician the next day and sort of fixed up my face a little bit. Yeah, for the cameras, a little boo makeup there, you know, because it was starting to turn a little bit yellow. After a great pep talk, he decided, you know, can you do it? And I said, I think I can do it. And so we got a real cop. Actually, we got a couple of cops that I became, and I'm still friends with them to this day, the cops that took care of me. And that was the story of the Ferris wheel. And I was on the Ferris wheel for 21 days, 10 hours, and 10 minutes. And I did it. I'll never do it again. Okay, that's it.
What did you win?
I won a really ugly car. It was an Austin Marina. I don't even know who makes them. British Leyland, I think, was. And I won a washer and dryer, which Debbie. And it's funny that what we did, we sold the car, we sold the washer and dryer, and we bought property.
We bought property up in the same area where we are
right now, just down the road from where. So I took that money. So we couldn't afford a house, but we could afford a cottage. And we bought
a lot.
Yeah, and we built on the lot. And that's where we are today. Oh, I forgot about that.
What happened on April Fool's Day?
Oh, yeah. Okay, one just, that was a bad one, too. Yeah, I always liked War of the Worlds, and I said, wouldn't it be great to be able to panic the world like that one day? Wouldn't it be great? I think I'd like to do that, you know, like Orson Welles did. So it was April Fool's, and I decided, wouldn't it be great if, you know, I got shot? It'll be fun. Yeah, so somebody, you know, has phoned up and doesn't like me or the radio show, and he decides that he's going to come down and he's going to shoot me. And I've been saying this all during the show, and of course it was late at night. Bob was asleep, thank God, and you were too, yeah, so you had no idea what the hell was going on. It was so real what I did it with the sound effects, and I did get shot, and a guy came in, you could hear him saying, you know, I said, starter pistols don't scare me, so, you know, and he goes, this is no joke. And it was one of the producers that was the voice. Steve Mitchell, Jesus, good for you.
I was in the comedy department. I was working late at night.
Oh, gee.
Because I always was. It's the All Night Show. And he comes in, and not because I thought it would be the wrong thing to do, I said, no, I got to get smokes, I got a condition. And it was Steve who did it. It was about 2:05. And as soon, I had the radio on, and as soon as the, I knew what was going on, but it was still horrifying. And I hear the gunfire, and I leave the comedy department. The comedy department just around the corner, not far from your old office. And I run down the hallway, and by the time I got to the studio, there were two cops standing there.
Yeah. And then...
they were listening.
They cordoned off Young Street because they, well, you know, a disc jockey, a chum jock is in trouble. I let them in because none of the newsroom, of course, was right on Young Street. They're banging at the door. I let them in, and one guy with a rifle runs up the stairs, and I go, excuse me, oh, God, I'm in trouble, Jesus. And so the other guys, I said, listen, can you come in the studio because I'm on the air? And I said, listen, it was an April Fool's joke. He said, it's a joke. I said, yeah, it's a joke. It's like, it's funny. And he goes, what's the funny part? And I went, the funny part is, I'm not sure of the funny part right now, but at the time, it seemed like a really good idea. Well, they had closed off Young Street. It was, I remember a guy by the name of SWAT team, Paul Talbot says, oh my God, the place is crawling with cops. That wasn't fearful. I mean, that part scared me, but what really scared me was the call from Bob in the morning. Yeah, that was a bad call. Mike, what have you done to my radio station? It was a joke. It was a joke. So Bob says, I need you to come in right now. Okay, so I go into Bob. I remember, does anybody remember Wes Armstrong? Yeah. He is so mad at me. The hallways of CHUM, of course, you know, there's cinder blocks on either side. There's not much room to get by. I saw Wes coming one way, and I was going towards Bob's office, and he bumped me. He actually gave me the shoulder like that. He actually gave me a check. He was so mad. He was a big boy, right? I go into Bob's office once again. He's got his back to me, and he's in that prayer mode. He plays the tape back. Oh God, that's I'm in trouble. And he did say, you know that? I gotta tell you, Mike, in his soft words, Mike, I gotta tell you, that was great radio. But now I gotta tell you how much trouble you're in, and I can't save your job. And I went, well, what about the other part that was great radio? Nope, it's just Toronto Star, murder at CHUM, disc jockey hoax, letters this big like man on moon. It's like that. The cops came in. Bob, God love him, steered them off to the side, and he said they wanted to know what happened. And he said, so you guys are familiar with the War of the Worlds, right? Orson Welles? And, oh, yeah, we took that in school. He said, he tried to recreate that moment. And I said, he's dancing for me. He's saving me. I mean, he's really saving me. So Bob said, listen, you got to go home, and I'll get back to you. Well, he didn't. A day passed, and then Tom Rivers and a couple other jocks started to phone in sick. And I was the swing guy. They didn't have anybody for the radio. Bob calls me back in again. Can you do tonight? I went for Scott Carpenter. I went, yeah, I'm there. And I never heard another word about it. I got away with it. I mean, you couldn't do it now. But Bob saved my life. He really, really honestly saved my life. Wes Armstrong never got over it, though. I got to admit, no. He was really mad about that part, yeah. And then Tom and I took his tires off his car. That's another story. All right, I am really good. All right, that's April Fool's. Now, it's anybody.
I briefly got to interject the most diabolical.
Oh my God, how are you?
Talking your 17-year-old operator.
That's right.
This is a good thing.
It's Bruce Marshall. Oh my God! I never even saw you, Bruce. I didn't even know you were over there. Bruce was on the board at the time, or was that Chris Coyle? That's what it was.
No, it was me.
It was you. It was, yeah. Wasn't it?
You threw the card across here.
That's right.
This is for tonight. We're gonna do a bit tonight, and I'm gonna get shot in the air.
That's right.
All right.
And I remember the cop saying, "Where's the gun? Where's the gun?" I said, "No, no, it's a sound effects record." He goes, "No, where's the gun?" I went, "No, but it's a sound effects record." Jesus, yeah. Christ. And so that's the story. It's great to see you. I didn't even see you over there. That's wonderful. I'll be darned.
Bruce, where did I send you? Wawa.
Shit. What did he do? All right. Far too many stories. Other stories. Somebody take the mic. I'm out of here. Anybody? Okay, I'll just set it down then.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Bob.
We've earned an encore, and we'll be back to you in a few minutes.
No, no, no.
I'd like to introduce some operators who went on to fame and fortune in the sales department, and then programming and managing some radio stations in Ontario, who also has a great story to tell that he shared with me back at the CHUM reunion last year, which I wasn't even aware of all of the background on that story, but here's John Tucker to tell us that story.
John, this is live.
Oh boy.
It's being recorded outside.
Let's not mention names.
No, great. I wish I kind of knew that part.
give me a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Bob, before I tell this story, I'm awfully hot. That's a cue for you.
Why'd you take it? I don't get it.
You did send me on a mission, and I'm hot wearing this jacket.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
I'm so sorry, I forgot about this.
There
you
go.
Yeah.
Again, another senior's moment here. But this was such an important get-together that I thought that we would bring in some of the royalty from the United States. And in particular, we have a special guest who is self-identified by the shirt that he's wearing. And he is this gentleman.
And this is partly for Warren.
Yep.
Finally, I can take this jacket off.
Yeah, you
got it. Wow,
isn't that something?
That's right.
I don't have any water, so hopefully I can get through this story. But this is well timed because Coop, it involves you too.
Oh, Jesus.
And let's see how good your memory is. Back in the day, and we talked about this earlier, Jay had his thermos, but we had the Osmond room. And some giggles go around the room. We had the Osmond room, and it's Saturday night. It's 7 o'clock.
Anybody what the Osmond room is?
Well, they'll have to find out because I was never there. I was never there. But the Osmond room was actually Jerry Kowalski's closet in the back of the, and we called it the Osmond room because that's where we snuck Donny Osmond in because there was such craziness going on out front on Yonge Street. We had to bring him in through a back door, and it was in honor of all that thing was called the Osmond room. But we used to go and visit Jerry Kowalski's closet in the back and have a little relaxing moment from time to time.
This
absolutely. This is the 70s, after all. So it's a Saturday night. Coop and I are on. We're doing 6 to mid. And it's in the middle of ratings. It's fall ratings. And one of the ratings thing that CHUM was doing at that point was the special of the week. And the special of the week was a one-hour taped program that would feature an artist and do interviews and play songs and that sort of thing. It was boring as hell for Coop and I to do because we're just sitting there picking our noses. I'm running commercials and IDs and filling out the log, and Coop's on the phone talking to Debbie, I'm sure. Yeah. But what? Anyway, we're doing the thing, and it gets boring. And I don't know whose idea it was, but somebody said, well, we've got a 10-minute segment coming up. Let's just go back to the Osmond room. Hell of an idea. So I carefully put the stopwatch around my So I know how many seconds and minutes I have left before we have to be back to run the next set of spots and so on. And we go into the newsroom, and there's Mark Daly there. I said, Marco, we're going back to the newsroom. Come on. He says, yeah, I'll be back in a minute. Just got to finish this cart. And we go, and Rick Ringer's doing his stuff on Chum FM. We say, Rick, we're going in the newsroom. Come on in. So there's Goop and me, Ringer, and we're back in there, and we're having a hell. And we hear this down the hallway. What that was Mark Daly with his giant long legs. He's running. But it takes a long time for the steps to hit. He's coming in, and the door opens up, and he says, "Jeez, it's wood." Coop goes one way, I go the other way. I'm coming from the area up the front where the washroom is. So I'm zipping up, and Wood's standing at the door of the newsroom with the jock booth right there and the op booth right there, and he's looking. He's not even doing his prayer thing. He's just looking. And anyone who's ever received that look will know that it has nothing to do with stature or size. It has to do with that look that a snake gives to a mouse that freezes him in his steps. And he looks, he sees me, he says, "Where were you?" And Coop has written by, "And where were you?" And he said, "There's no one in the control room, there's no one in the jock booth, and we're off the air." Run it now. I'm a good guy, technically. I run in, we're off the air, the tape machine's not running, but I look over, so we have no modulation, but we have a carrier, so the transmitter's fine. You just aren't working, tape's not running, I don't know. Put a jingle in, 1, 2, 3, because it takes a couple of seconds for the tape to come up, the drive to come up to speed. Dun, 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 10:50, Chum hit a song. Okay, we're back on the air. I go to check the tape out. There's nothing wrong with it. The tape's fine. And he comes to the door and he says, "I stopped the tape. I just wanted to see how long it was going to take someone to notice." This is in the middle of ratings. And he looked at me and he said, "Don't you ever leave this control room unmanned. Don't you ever leave the jock booth unmanned again." And he spun on his heel and he left. And I still had my job after that. How, I don't know, but I can tell you, I've never forgotten that moment, and I never will for the rest of my life. Absolute harrowing night.
That's a scary story.
Do you remember that?
You know, I tell you.
Who's up? Okay, who would like to go next?
Okay, I can't stand up. I'm sitting 1975.
But you can stand
up. Okay, I'll try to stand up.
Oh, have you got a problem with your leg?
Or? No. Well, I do, but...
You got a problem with standing.
So, I'm just a kid from Winnipeg, working with Warren, working with Bob. 1975, I'm sitting at the console. Door to the studio flies open. It's Mr. Cosford. I was still on the Mr. Cosford, Mr. Wood terminology. I was just so intimidated. Warren comes over, puts his arms down on the tape machine. Bob wants us to do an Elvis Presley special. So I'm thinking special. Okay, well, we got some clips. Get some tunes out of the library. Get a script. I could have it ready tomorrow, Warren. Not a problem. So he says, "No. It's a little bit bigger than that." He said, "It's probably going to be 6 hours long." I says, "Okay, well, 5 hours to produce an hour. So that's okay, we'll say 30 to 40 hours. And we leave for Memphis tomorrow." I said, "What?" He says, "Yeah, we're lined up in Memphis and Nashville. We've got interviews. We're going to be gone 3 or 4 days. So I said, "Okay, give me a minute." Phone. "Dear? I'm going to be gone for a few days, and then I'm going to be gone another 2 weeks to produce this thing. So down to Memphis and Nashville, we phone in at night with all these interview clips and everything that we've got." I think it was Bill McDonald was locked up at the Roehampton Suite Hotel, writing away, filling in the blanks, have the script ready when we come back. And who voiced, was it Charlie? Charlie Van Dyke. Warren says, "Bob, you're picking Charlie up at the airport on Saturday. We're voicing Saturday and Sunday. You start producing Monday. It's got to go to the air that fast." Okay? So now I'm gone 3 weeks. And we got it on air, a great, great show. It was just everything clicked. And then it felt like, I don't know, 3 hours later, door flies open to my studio again. It's Warren. I can call him Warren now. Onto the tape machines. Bob wants us to produce a history of rock. I said, oh, man. He says, is it as long as Elvis? Yeah, yeah. How long is it, Warren? Well, we're thinking 64 hours. So I mean, shit, that's like 10 times the length of Elvis Presley. And then I'm starting to do the math, and it's like 300 or 400 hours of production time. Pick up the phone. Hi, honey, it's me. Yeah. So we're doing a documentary. It's May. I'm shooting to be home for Christmas. So at least I don't have to be on the road. Everything started to click. But the only thing is, I have to work evenings, all nights, weekends, holidays, birthdays, anniversaries. Just every second that we had to spare was in the studio. Getting this done, we brought the production team down to daytime so I could come in at night when it was nice and quiet, no phones, no interruptions. So tell Lynn I'm going to be home Christmas. So we get through the history of rock. Warren moves on into CHUM FM now. He's a program director, and door flies open to my studio. I said, oh, my God, it's Ashby. He says, Bob wants us to produce a short documentary that we can take into the school. I said, short? He said, yeah, like 30 minutes. I said, oh, man, that's easy. All you need is a bunch of songs. We can sweep them. Give me a script. I can have it ready Friday. Well, it's a little bit longer than that. He said, it's video. And I just said, video? We don't have any videos. And he said, I know. He said, we've got nothing. And Elvis clips aren't going to help us. So he says, plus, we're going to have to go up to Barrie to produce this thing. As in where CKVR is? He says, yep. And we're going to use the downtime at the TV station to produce this video. We're radio guys. I haven't got a clue what a video is. So sure enough, get it all set up. Somehow Roger lined up clips from artists. I'm sure he was hitting up all of these record companies. We go up to Barrie, and we work for a few hours. They need the studio for on-air live. We go down. We come back. It's just like a windshield wiper for 24 hours. And then we turn around and go back to Toronto and do our regular 9-to-5 production stuff. And we did that for weeks and weeks and weeks because there was no videos. At one point, we had Larry here working all night at CKVR in Barrie. We had no Beach Boys video. We had an album jacket. And Larry was the cameraman at that point. He took the camera. We're in the control room. He took the camera and ran it slowly up around and down and back. And that was our Beach Boys footage for the history of rock. Wow. And then we had a huge hole to fill, and we couldn't figure out how to do it. So Bill French at the time, he said, well, I've got a classic car. I've got a Studebaker. Let's just shoot some footage, and we can run it behind the script. And so Bill, down some gravel road near Barrie, and I think it ran like 3 minutes in the history of rock, was a Studebaker coming at us through a cloud of dust. And I don't know that we ever refilled that one. But and then the video history of rock was something that kind of had a life of its own, because we started that in 1977, and we finished it in 1985. Every year was updated to current standards. So when we went into a school, CHUM was current, and everything. I, to this day, I don't know how we kept it to time, but it was just, it was a phenomenal experience. And I really think that CHUM became so well known and so respected a lot because of the documentaries that you started. And it's all your fault. So I'm still recovering, but those days were just absolutely tremendous days, and we thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
I'll be really quick here. Phone rings one morning. It's Samina. Bob would like to see you in his office right away. Like, what do you mean by right away? She said, right away. Okay, so I get down Young Street, get in the station, and there in the hallway is Gord James. And I'm looking at Gord and say, what are you in for? He says, Bob wants to see me. When? Right away. Bob opens the door. Now, this is how quick he is, okay? He opens the doors. Come on in. Sit down. Gord, Steve, I'm putting you both on 90 days notice. What for? We didn't do anything. That's why.
This isn't a funny story because most of the years I worked with Bob at Chum, I was so scared of him, there's nothing funny. So, but there is something I wanted to mention that was unfortunately cut out of the video today that you saw, because I had more to say than that, especially about something that Bob and I worked on many years ago called the famous Stephen Truscott interview, which we did under very, very trying and somewhat strange circumstances that required a very high level of CHUM corporate approval to do. And Bob put himself out to actually get me the tools and the arrangements to be able to do that. That interview of this 14-year-old boy who was sentenced to hang, actually, for the murder of a 12-year-old girl near London, Ontario, eventually commuted to life imprisonment, went on for years. There were two or three books, there was a movie, and I was the only person to actually do a full-length interview with Stephen Truscott. That got world publicity. It was headlines at the time that occurred. It was such a huge event for CHUM at the time that we actually had to have two news conferences in the building just to handle the press as a result of the interview, because it was the first one of its kind. And I'm so thankful and honored that it was only just 5 years ago that I was given the Masterworks Award from the Canadian Film Institute, which enshrined, in fact, the Truscott interview in the National Archives. And I couldn't have done that in the 7,000 interviews I have done in my career, in most of them, by the way, at CHUM. I couldn't have done this most important interview without the help of this man sitting there, who was the inspiration of my broadcasting life. So, Bob, thank you again.
Chance to talk on the video, but there's one thing that Larry, as Brian was saying, we all had lots and lots to say on the video that never get in, but I'm hoping that you will get a chance to see everything that was on the video. I just want to say personally that, you know, I was at CHUM for 3 years in the copy department, and I left. I thought I wanted to get in the advertising agency business because that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to do TV ads and I wanted to do print ads and stuff, and so I went and went to an ad agency. My creative director at CHUM at the time, Steve Boiling, was hired as a creative director, and he called me and hired me away. And I went, and I hated the agency business. I just hated it because it wasn't a radio station, and it especially wasn't CHUM. You know, and it wasn't CHUM in so many ways. There was no music. There was no lunatics in the hallway. The doors were always closed. It was a business. You know, it could have been an insurance business. And I'd just been married, and the agency was in Yorkville. So my days were spent showing up at work at 10 o'clock in the morning. We mostly had record industry accounts and concert accounts. And so my job consisted of going out to lunch with clients in Yorkville and drinking all afternoon and going back to work at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and answering my messages and going home.
That's
how
we did it, CHUM.
No. And I was there 5 months, and the phone rang one day, and it was Bob, and he said, "Are you ready to come back?" I was only 23 years old. And I said, "Yeah, but I don't want to be in the copy department anymore. I've kind of done that." And Bob said, "Well, let's get together and meet, and we'll talk about it." And we had lunch, and Bob said to me, "You know, make a list of everything you want to do, and I'll sign it, and you can come back." And so I went home, and I talked to my wife, and I said, "Well, I want to do comedy, and I want to do a morning show, and I want to do television, and I want to do all kinds of things, and I don't want to work with everybody and for nobody." And it was a ridiculous list of things I wanted to do at 23. And I meet with Bob again, and Bob looks at the list, and he says, "Well, we can do that." And you know, I teach at Humber now, and I teach at Seneca, and I try to give them a sense of what it was like to work at CHUM, especially in those days, and with people as remarkable as Bob, who a 23-year-old kid, I have sons now who are in their 30s, and I remember when they would become 22 and 23 and 24, and they're still children to me, and I would go, I can't believe that anybody would have seen in me at that point what Bob saw in me. And Bob changed my life. Everything I have in my life is because Bob had more faith in me than I had in myself. And it wasn't just me. It was all of the people that Bob hired very young. He hired Mike very young. He hired Roger. Roger was on the air at CHUM the weekend before Woodstock. And he would see in young people especially talent and character. And he knew he would be able to form them into professionals. And him inviting me back, Bob, you inviting me back in 1976 to spend another 35 or 37 years at that radio station, gave me everything that I have today and everything I'm able to pass on to my students and my own children. And it's because of you. And I'm glad that I got a chance to say that, because I said it when they interviewed me for the video, and it, you know, you can only put so much in the video, but I just want to thank you, Bob. It means so much to me to be here. Thank you.
Me?
God, no.
Okay. Well, I was actually one of the few people maybe in this room that was a CHUM before Bob Wood was. I started in February of 65, and I was I was an 18-year-old kid, and I thought you had to be 19 to work at CHUM, so I lied and said I was 19. But I was there for 5 years. Bob came in. He was just this surreptitious guy in the library that we didn't know what he was doing. He was just kind of looking around and listening to everything, and we didn't know he had spies in the building, too, that were going on. I mean, when he eventually became program director, I'd left in late 69, that's when Warren came in, to go to work for Ted Randall, who was CHUM's consultant. And that lasted a year when Ted folded his business. So I came back to Toronto, and I didn't have a job. I was living in David Haydu, Geets's basement, and he was an engineer at CHUM at the time. He wasn't Pete and Geets yet. He comes home one day and says, Bob Wood wants to see you. Okay. And same thing. Bob Wood says, do you want to come back to work? Yeah, absolutely. How much do you think you're worth? This is exactly what he said to me. Not how much do you want. He says, how much do you think you're worth? And I'm 20, I guess, at that time. I said, well, I don't think I'm worth $10,000 a year. I'll take $9,600. And then he marches me right upstairs. No, actually, he did say $10,000. Then he marches me right upstairs to Fred Sherratt's office, introduces me again to Fred, and Fred sticks out his hand and says, welcome to the five-figure club. It's like, what? Good God. But that first year in 70, Warren was already there, so I was working with Warren. And Warren graciously took the tiny little room in the back known as Studio 54, which is the smallest production studio on the planet. I had the big studio at the front. And Bob, again, Warren didn't come in and open the door and put his hands on the thing, but he called Warren and I into his office in 1970 and said, CKFH, which was our big competition at the time, they're going to do this History of Rock from Drake. We got to do something bigger. We're going to do a 12-hour documentary on the Beatles. We didn't have anything either. We had nothing at all. So somehow, and it had to be done within a couple of weeks. We didn't have 18 years, Bob. You know, we had a couple of weeks. We had a couple of weeks. So literally, we brought Bill McDonald, who was a writer in the copy department at the time, started writing it again. We brought Chuck Riley, Chuck Dan, Chuck Hanks, whatever he was calling himself at the time, up from Indianapolis. And anybody that's ever worked with Chuck Riley knows he's a curmudgeon of a guy. And he's a tough guy to work with, but you got to work with him. So he recorded the script one weekend, and this thing was going to be on the air a week Monday. So Warren took his hours, and I took my hours. And unfortunately, something happened. We had no time, really. We really had no time. So the first day that I was there, on the Monday, I started on the Monday, and somehow I was wearing these stupid hush puppy shoes that somehow my ankle got scraped. And I didn't leave the building for 5 days. And my foot swelled up
to the size of like twice the size. I couldn't take my shoes off. And literally, it all got finished. And finally, it got finished. And Geets, my friend, took me to the hospital where I was for a couple of days. Bob, being the great guy that he was, brought me a baked potato. Now, most people that know me know I have eclectic eating habits, and I love baked potatoes. So he actually went to seniors and got me a baked potato and brought it to the hospital room. But the other thing about Bob was Warren and I and Doug Rawlinson, and not Bill McDonald necessarily, but we were there all night, a lot of the times all night. Now, a lot of program directors at radio stations would be home sleeping. Not Bob. At 3 in the morning, he was there. And he went up to Fran's, the only place open at 3 in the morning, and got us all hamburgers and hot dogs or whatever else we wanted. He was right part of the team. He didn't leave us to do it unless he was there with us helping. And that's Bob Wood.
I'll just continue a little about a couple of those stories. The significant thing about the Beatles was that Bob Wood decided, after we had produced the show and all the CHUM stations around the country were running it, Bob Wood decided to give it away to any radio station anywhere for the cost of the tape. So what that meant was the story of the Beatles by CHUM was being played all over North America. Now, why was that significant? Well, you heard the story from Bob about the Elvis Presley story. There were some sidebars in Elvis that will stay with me forever. When we heard that we had to do the Elvis Presley story, at that time, believe it or not, 1975, there was one book on Elvis Presley. It's by a guy named Jerry Hopkins. I bought two copies of it. Bill McDonald went into the Mount Sudan Hotel and started to write. Took the second book, and I listed all the people that Jerry Hopkins had talked to about Elvis. And then I called Memphis and Nashville information to get phone numbers. And every person I called that had a phone number that answered the phone, and I told the story, we're doing this Elvis Presley show, everyone said, I'll have to call you back. And everyone called us back and said, okay, that we were able to reach. And so we had, I think, maybe 10, 12 people when we first were preparing to go to Memphis and Nashville. One person I was trying to reach, of course, was Mae Axton, the mother of Hoyt Axton, who wrote Heartbreak Hotel. And I tracked her down in Broken Bow, Oklahoma. But there was no answer. Didn't think anything more about it. It was just someone else that I couldn't reach. Steve Boiling, who worked in the copy department, on the day we were leaving for Memphis, came into my office and said, you'll never guess who's coming to CHUM. I said, who? Mae Axton. Mae Axton is coming to CHUM today. That's right. She's doing an interview on CHUM FM. Why? Hoyt Axton, her son, has a TV special. So she's out promoting it. And it's being broadcast on the CTV television network. So Bob and I had Mae Axton in the studio while the cab was waiting outside CHUM for us to go to the airport. I mean, this is like, I mean, there's something going on here. And Mae Axton was wonderful. She told us the whole story about Elvis. Even more significant than having written Heartbreak Hotel, she had a TV show in Shreveport, Louisiana. It was the first TV show that Elvis Presley performed on. And she had a tape of Elvis Presley singing That's All Right, Mama. And she said she would send it to us. And she did. So we got out into the cab, flew off to Memphis, and our first interview is with some guy that had been mentioned in the book that had grown up with Elvis when they were both 10 years old, whatever. So we're doing this interview, and he's in a lawyer's office in Memphis. Bob and I are on the elevator. We get off the elevator, and there are two arrows One arrow points to the law office. The other arrow points to the Memphis Southmen football team, owned by Johnny Bassett of Toronto, coached by Leo Cahill of the Toronto Argonauts, former CHUM sportscaster, who I trained to be on the air at CHUM. Let's go see Leo, see if he's around. We go around to the office, and there's Leo Cahill. What are you guys doing here? Well, we're coming here to do this stuff with Elvis Presley. What is that around your neck? It's the medallion. It's solid gold. It's shaped in a thunderbolt. The letters TCB across it. It was the medallion that Elvis Presley gave to people that he cared about. Elvis Presley was a football fan. Leo said, you getting cooperation on your Elvis thing? I said, well, we got, you know, some interviews, we got some appointments. I said, hold on. He picked up the phone. I'll never forget this, Bob. You remember this. Leo Cahill suddenly had a southern drawl. And he's on the phone, and he's talking to Richard Davis, who was a guy who hadn't called me back, who ran Stax Records in Memphis, who was the only one that Priscilla allowed to stay at the mansion after she and Elvis got married. And he's talking to Richard, and he said, I got some good old boys in here from Canada. They're doing this. Oh, you know about that. Well, I'd really appreciate it. Anything you can do for them would be a favor to me. And now we got a whole bunch more interviews to do. The last person that I could not reach, and the only one that had an answering machine, was Gordon Stoker of the Jordanaires, who were the background singers for all of Elvis' stuff on RCA. But I hadn't been able to reach him, and Bob and I are at the Holiday Inn, now we're in Nashville, and we're leaving like the next morning, and the phone rings, and it's Gordon Stoker. And I explained, Mr. Stoker, we're here, and we're doing Elvis, and well, I'll have to call you back. Of course, everybody's gonna call me back. He called back, and he said, look, there's a lot of construction in Nashville. He said, well, I'll come to the hotel. I said, great. Gordon Stoker walked into the room, and he said, so you know why you're getting all this cooperation from Elvis? I said, no, I don't know, I guess it's CHUM, big radio station, no. He said, Elvis heard your Beatle documentary. And he said, give them all the help they need. And then Gordon Stoker said, you've been getting the party line about Elvis. I'm gonna tell you the truth. All I ask you to do is be discreet. And he told us that Elvis would be dead within 5 years. That's a true story. And that
I was there.
And so it was like there was kind of a, I don't know. I mean, I don't, I'm a Christian, but I'm not religious, but there was just something about how all of those things came together. But that's not the last one. Called RCA as we're setting the whole thing up with Elvis, and Barry Hogan at RCA told me, there's a guy in town that used to work for Elvis, but I don't think he'll talk to you. And Barry Hogan said, no, I'm sorry, he doesn't want to talk about Elvis. I didn't think anything more about it. That was 1975. It's now 1978, and I'm programming CHUM FM, and one of the things that I do at that time was live broadcast from the El Macombo. And at one point, 1978, we did 62 live broadcasts at the El Macombo on CHUM FM. And the fellow who organized it all for me was a guy named John Cardina, who was just fabulous. And the quality was outstanding. His engineer was a guy named Ed Weidman. Very nice man, very quiet. I hardly ever spoke to him. It was mostly Cardina. But Ed was upstairs all the time.
And I went in for a, a show, and there was Ed. And for the first time I could remember, he wasn't wearing a T-shirt. He had unopened that shirt. And around his neck was the medallion. He was wearing the Elvis Presley medallion. And I said, Ed, where did you get that? He said, I got it from Elvis. You got that from Elvis Presley? He said, yeah. I said, what did you do with Elvis Presley? He said, I worked for him. I said, really? Did you like engineer some shows? And no. Ed, what did you do? I sang. You were in J.D. Sumner and the Stamps? If you ever see Elvis from Hawaii by satellite, which was a huge deal at the time when it was done, on stage left, there is J.D. Sumner and the Stamps. And on one microphone, there is J.D. Sumner. On another microphone, there are two other guys. And in between them all is Ed Wideman from Stouffville, Ontario, Canada.
I'm just going to add two quick asides about those documentaries that were all really very special. One of them was that the Beatle documentary, which played all over the world, ended up being the inspiration for the BBC in London to decide they had better do a Beatle documentary. After all, they were in England. So I get a phone call one day from a guy by the name of John Bierling, who is the program director of the BBC. And he said, we've heard about your program, and he said, if you don't mind, we'd like to come over and make a copy of some of your interviews, because we want to do the program. I said, okay, sure. So think about it. The BBC are coming to CHUM in Toronto to get a copy of all the stuff that our guys assembled to do their program. I mean, that's how thorough our team was, and it was well done. And another quick aside on the story of the Beatles. We felt that we wanted to include in the program a current interview with one of the Beatles. It didn't matter which one, but it had to be a current interview. So I called the president at Capitol Records, and I think it was Arnold Gossowich at the time. And he called me back about a week later, and he said, I'm sorry. He said, I can't do it. He said, you'll have to call Bhaskar Menon in Los Angeles. Bhaskar was the president of Capitol USA. So we contacted Bhaskar Menon's office, and they couldn't help us. So then we thought, okay, well, we'll contact EMI in England, because EMI owned Capitol Records. And EMI couldn't get the interviews for us of the Beatles. So one day, I forget who it was who told me this, he said, why don't you call Pete Bennett? I said, who's Pete Bennett? He said, he's the promo guy for Abco Records. And Abco Records was the company of the Beatles in America at the time. So I called Pete Bennett, and he said, hey, what can I do for you? And I said, well, we're looking for an interview and blah, 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 this program that we're doing, this interview. He said, no problem. He said, who do you want? Which one do you want? I said, it doesn't matter. We'll take any one of the guys. We just need a current interview. He said, okay. He said, how about Ringo? I said, great. He said, okay. He said, we'll be back to you. Within 30 minutes, I got a call from Ringo. He was on the beach with his girlfriend on vacation in Spain. And he called and he said, hey, mate, what can I do for you? And I said, whoa, let me go to the studio. We'll get something on tape here. So we went on for like about an hour with this interview. And at the end of the interview, I thanked him profusely. And he said, is there anything else you need? And I said, no. I said, this has been really wonderful. I really appreciate it. Thank you very much. He said, well, he said, here's my number. If you need it, call me anytime. I said, thank you very much. So we finished up the program, got it on the air. And about, I guess, I think, first of all, a couple of days later, I called P. Bennett. And I said, thank you very much, P. He said, don't mention it. No problem. A couple months later, I get a call from Pete Bennett. And Pete said, we've got a new album coming out from Ringo, and wondering if you'd give it a play. And I said, by all means, we'll be happy to consider it. Send it up. He said, what do you mean, consider it? We did you a favor. Now you better do us a favor. And right away, I realized even the Beatles were captured by the mob in those days, because there was heavy mob influence in the business. So fortunately, there were two cuts on that album we would have played anyway, and I ended up not being at the bottom of the Detroit River. So, how about Chuck McCoy? Chuck, you want to say a few words?
In that big, deep voice, Chuck.
Yeah. Well, you see. I don't really have a funny story. I mean, I have lots of funny stories to tell. I'll let Paul Ski tell those ones. But Bob has been very magnanimous in his speech today and what he said here about the team and all the people that worked at CHUM and how important they were. But we all know how important Bob Wood was to us, and as a team and individually. And I'm just one guy in the business, and I met Bob 51 years ago. Do I know you longer than anybody else in this room?
My mother was wheeling me down according to the carriage.
But I met Bob 51 years ago. I was a teenage guy, just arrived at the radio station. Bob had been doing the all-night show and had moved into the 9 to midnight slot, and I was going to the all-night show. And so I thought, well, here's an experienced guy, and I'll talk to him, and he'll give me the lay of the land. And but I didn't know the rules. Like, you just don't walk into a studio where the guy's on the air doing his show, especially J. Robert Wood doing his show. And but he was very kind. He said, I'd be happy to help you, but you can't talk to me while I'm on the air. Could you call me later? Could you talk to me later? And I did. I ran into him in the hallway or Sal's below the radio station, and he said, okay, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take you out to a record hop. And like, I've never been a DJ before, so I don't even know. So, well, what are we going to do? Well, you'll see. We're going to go out. So we drove out to some record hop. We used to get $25 to go out and do a record hop for at these teen clubs. And he said, I want you to go up on stage. I said, geez, I've just been on the air a week. I can't go up. I don't know what to do. He said, I'm going to give you a bunch of records. You're going to go up there and you're going to tell them who you are. And you're going to look out in that crowd. And not to be indelicate, but this is what he said to me. It wasn't me saying this. This was what J. Robert Wood said. He said, just look out on that crowd. Every guy out in that crowd wants to be you. And every woman out there is having an orgasm while you're standing up on the stage. And I said, really? That showbiz is good. And that day, and then subsequently, even though Bob was just another disc jockey on the station, but I was doing the All Night Show, and Bob would frequently call me and say, you know, I was thinking that if you didn't do that, or what are you, this record, I'm not sure that record's on the play, or whatever. And really helped develop my career as my very first radio station at CKY in Winnipeg. And then I moved off, and Bob left, and the station changed format. And I went to Regina, and I was doing a top 40 show, and I hated it. And Bob had now started CHLO in St. Thomas. And I heard the tapes of CHLO in St. Thomas, and Paul Ski was there, and Hal Weaver, and Bob was doing the morning show. And I thought, well, I got to work there. I got to work there. So I called Bob, and I said, Bob, I need a job, and da da da. And, you know, Bob said, well, I think, you know, he didn't really know. I had still only been on the air 10 months in my life. And he said, well, I might be able to do something, but I can't afford to move you. Move me would have been a gasoline for my Chevelle to get to, you know, London. But he says, no, I can't afford to do that. I said, oh, okay. Well, how am I going to get there? And Bob said, give Jim and Bob O'Brien a call in Niagara Falls. Well, what would that do? Well, they're looking for somebody, and they'll pay your way to go to Niagara Falls. And so I phoned them, and they listened to my tape, and they hired me, and I went to Niagara Falls. And so I phoned Bob up, and I said, "Okay, Bob, I'm in Niagara Falls. It's a short drive from Niagara Falls to London to St. Thomas, Ontario." And Bob hired me to come to St. Thomas. I did the all-night show. He said, "I got nothing but the all-night show. That's all I got for you." And that's what I did at that time. And I've told this story before, but it's the true story. There was a record that I played at CKY in Winnipeg when I was with Bob there. It was called "Born a Woman" by Sandy Posey. Probably nobody remembers that song, but "Born a Woman," Sandy Posey. It was the pick hit of the week at CKY. I was at CJME in Regina as it hit the top of the charts. I was in Niagara Falls as it slid down the charts, and when I got to St. Thomas, it was still on the playlist. So I went through four radio stations in the life of one record. And as we all talk, you know, Doug and Warren and Roger and all of us, Paul, we talk about how important Bob was to us in our lives and our careers. And somebody said the word, you know, life changer. I think of it, you know, I don't know what kind of a disc jockey I would have been. I don't know whether I ever would have got east to Ontario to a place like CHLO and St. Thomas. And of course, I had to get to CHUM. He didn't work at CHUM. So how am I going to get to CHUM? And at that time, CKFH was just motoring up the radio. In fact, the CHUM trailer would get tipped at remotes. Kids would kind of chip the CHUM trailer, and they were burning the CHUM cards because it was like burning the draft cards. And so I thought, I don't know if I want to go to CHUM. I think the CKFH is pretty good shit. I'm going to get a job there. So I phoned them, and they hired me to come up, and I worked with Don Daynard and Keith Hampshire and at CKFH, and we were blowing CHUM away. I mean, CHUM was just, you know, and there was so much wrong with that station, and I was just so happy I was at the station that was winning. And then I heard that Bob Wood had left CHLO in St. Thomas. Oh, well, that's too bad. Where's he going? He's gone to CHUM. So within about 8 months, it was a long, convoluted back and forth, but within about 8 months, I was out of CKFH. And I was at CHUM with Bob, and Bob hired me again, and I think it was a swing shift. He said, "That's all I've got." And so my whole career is going from Winnipeg and St. Thomas, and then now I'm at CHUM, and I couldn't have got any of those places without Bob. And what else could he do for me in my life? What else could he do? Well, I liked what he was doing. He was a program director. And I thought, well, I'd like to be a program director. So he gave me an opportunity with this guy. We were assistant PDs or whatever we were doing at the time. And taught me, gave me the lay of the land and the rules of the road for being a program director, and was instrumental in me getting my very first program director's job at CFUN in Vancouver. And I think, you know, people say this. They say, you know, I wouldn't be anywhere if it wasn't for so-and-so. Well, that's my story, and you can tell. I wouldn't be anywhere if it wasn't for that man, J. Robert Wood. And we had a CHUM reunion last year. Some of you were there. Doug Thompson and Warren, we worked on that. And unbeknownst to Bob Wood, we said, well, we've got to get Bob to come to this. And then, well, maybe we can. And I'd sort of send an email to Bob and say, well, I don't know, I might be able to make it. And then I'd send another email to him, and Doug, you were working on him. And the truth was, we didn't really want to do the reunion if Bob wasn't there. We knew we couldn't get him there if we said, this is a tribute to J. Robert Wood, so everybody come. You knew you wouldn't come if you did that. So we just tried to, yeah, you got to come, all the other guys are coming. Come on, Bob, you better come too. And with, I guess it was about a week before the reunion, I still wasn't sure whether he was coming. And I guess I ran into you at Joe Summers' funeral. And I guess if you want to get to a guy, you do it at a funeral. But I said, Bob, you got to tell me, are you coming or not? And he said he was coming, and of course he did come, and we had a great time. But I think, you know, there was millions and millions of funny stories and great things that went on. But there's so many of us in this room that have stories like mine that, truthfully, we would be nowhere if it wasn't for this guy here, J. Robert Wood. And I'll never be able to thank you enough for what you've done. Never. Thank you.
When I was working at CKY, they had a two-story building. CKY was on, well, actually a three-story building. CKY was on the second story. And the third story was where the accounting people were and the top management people and so on. And that was a place where you never went. And I worked in the evenings, and Chuck was the all-night jock. And so going up to the third floor was definitely not something you did. So I'm going to ask Chuck to tell me what he did when he went up to that third floor and what happened.
Well, I don't know which story you want on that one, but the one that I... Again, I wanted to learn about radio and be a program director. And I'm not sure if this is the story you're referring to, Bob. And
the elevator.
And previously to Bob being there, Jimmy Darren, is that the?
Yeah. I'm not sure who was there at the time.
Well.
Yeah. Remember when you got caught in the elevator?
I actually don't. I remember going up the elevator, and Jimmy Darren had been there, and he was a great PD at the station, and you talked about him all the time. And so I thought, I can put a tape on here, an hour tape, and I'll go up to the filing cabinets and see what's in the programming filing cabinets. And I went in, and I rifled all the filing cabinets with Jimmy Darren memos and kept them as a programming guide for... And nobody ever, but I don't remember ever getting caught in the elevator.
I remember that distinctly. I don't know whether it was when you were stealing Darren's memos or what you were doing, but the elevator got stuck between floors.
No, what did happen one time, and then I'll shut up, but what did happen one time is I was doing the all-night show, and I knew nothing about radio at all, and I thought, this is 6 hours. This is like, whoa, this is a long time. And I thought, maybe if I take those big 10-inch reels, Dougie, you know, the 10-inch reels, maybe if I record from midnight to 2 and just say it's past the hour, then at 2 I can put the same tape back on and it'll go from 2 to 4. And I didn't really think there was anything wrong with that. And I can doze off from time to time, as most people who know me know well. And I thought, I'd like to get some rest. And in those days, all the contests were done with mail-in, all mail-in. And then during the day, the daytime shows, they had all these mail-in. And there's no place to put the mailbags but in the control room. So the control room was, and I thought, well, that's kind of soft. And so I would fluff up the mailbags and catch a couple hours sleep before the next tape ran out. But one time I was there, and I was so damn hungry, and we had, below the radio station was Chan's Cafe, and I thought, if I phone them and say I want a burger and a milkshake, I can just run down. I had a 3-minute 45-second record, it was Cher, and 3-minute 45-second record, I'll run downstairs, grab milkshake and hamburger and come back up. Now, there's no keys at CKY, remember that? Just somebody who was in the control room always let somebody else in. And so I thought, okay, I'm gonna get something to prop this door open so I can go down to Chan's and get the thing. And as it turned out, when I opened the door, they had just put new linoleum down on the landing. And so when I opened the door, it just bound tight. And I thought, I don't even need to get it. I don't need to get anything to hold the door. The door is going to stay open with the floor. So I ran down to Chan's Cafe. I've been on the air now 5 months, you know, and I have no credibility at all. And I run down to Chan's, grab the milkshake, grab the hamburger, run back up the stairs, and that fucking door is closed. It's closed, and there's nobody inside, because this is the All Night Show. Nobody inside. There's no way to get in. And the first thought that came to my mind was, my car is parked across the street. I think I'll just get in it and drive out of town. Yeah. I think that's the best solution. I think, you know, maybe this radio thing wasn't for me, and I'll just. And I thought, oh, I don't know what I don't know. What else can I do? No, nothing else. I don't think. I don't want to phone the PD. I don't want to. No, I think I better just leave town. And then I thought, well, there is a fire escape at the back. And if you remember, Bob, the fire escape went down to the Criterion Hotel. Now, the newsmen in between newscasts would run down the fire escape, have a few beer, and then come up the fire escape and get in the back door.
That was street reporting.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I thought, well, what are the chances that that door is open? Except it's one of those doors with the bar on it, so if it's there's no way to open it from the outside. But I thought, I've got nothing to lose. So I had to run down McDermott and then through the back lane. And it was in the middle of winter, and I ran up the fire escape stairs, got to the landing. Son of a bitch. It snowed, and the snow had just propped the door open a tad. Just a tad. And I thought, my life has been saved. I flung open the door, and now I had to go from the back all the way down the hall, remember, to the studio. Well, I was 19, I can run fast, and so I just ran like crazy. And the thing that got me, that record's still not over. That 3-minute and 45-second record is still going. I've done all of this in less than 3 minutes and 45 seconds. Ran into the control room, got down, sat down, before the record was over, we read the news, the DJs read the news. Right in time for the news, turned on the mic and read the news, and learned one thing very, very important for announcers. If you've been running, and you're out of breath, don't turn the microphone on.
I have two more guys I want to go to here, and then a couple of ladies. So, and just before I forget, Chuck was very familiar with the length of records, because Roger Ashby used to say, when Chuck did 9 to Midnight and then Roger came on to do the All Night Show, Chuck would put Hey Jude on the air as his last record so he could get out of the studio and get home before the next show started. So he's familiar. Anyway, Dr. Don Regan, or Tom Brownlie, was someone we hired from CKLW back in the 70s, and he did our weekends. And he also was the guy who held us together in the contest and promotion area, writing the copy and inventing the ideas that we used on the air for a few years, 3 or 4 years, was it, Tom? And that was sort of between Bill McDonald and Larry McGinnis. So Don was the guy, and he's been a great friend to all of us all of those years. He went back to New York to work at WOR-FM in New York, and then shortly after, he started the New Contemporary School of Broadcasting in Massachusetts, I believe.
It's in New York.
Okay, so please, tell us your favorite stories.
Well, I'll tell you one fast story, which kind of is indicative of Bob. We were working on a lot of different promotions, and this particular time we had a premiere for the Beatles movie. And Bob called me, I was in his office, and we were, you know, chatting about what we were gonna do. And Bob said, we have the entire theater to give away, it's the premiere, and we have something like 1,000 albums. And he said, you know, go to work on it, write some promos, write some, you know, one-liners. So I started working on this whole thing and writing up the promos, and the production guys produced the promos, and they were running. The jocks started reading the one-liners, and everything I thought was going very well. And I get a call from Bob. He says, we have a minor problem. He said, you better come into my office. So I come in and sit down, and Fred Sherratt comes in shortly thereafter. And Fred Sherratt can be a pretty intimidating figure. At least he certainly was that particular day. He walked in, he slammed the door. Bob was over there behind his desk. I was here against his wall. Fred came in and sat over here. And turns out that my calculations weren't quite right, and we gave away two theaters, and we gave away twice as many albums as we had to give away. And Fred Sherratt was, there was steam coming out of his ears, and he looked over, how could you make a mistake like this? I felt myself shrinking back into the chair. I felt the need to go to the men's room very quickly. You know, you can sometimes feel like about this big in life when you're under that kind of an attack from an intimidating figure like Fred Sherratt. With that, he got out of the chair, he glared at me, he looked over at Bob like, what the hell are you thinking letting this guy make this calculation? He walked out the door and slammed the door, and I was just kind of sitting there wondering where all this was going, and Bob spun around and he said, the only people that don't make mistakes are people that don't do anything. So that was Bob's response, and I repeated that to a lot of people.
Well, that's a good story.
And in about the next 5 minutes, Bob spun around, got on the phone, called all the people that ran the record companies. He had a second theater and a second set of records, and everything was solved. Thank you, Bob.
William Anderson. Bill and I go back a little bit further than my CHUM days. He came to work at CHUM as an operator, and then... Well, he's had an amazing career, but I should tell you that I actually first met him in St. Thomas when I was working at CHLO. I don't know whether he'll...
I remember that.
Do you remember the stage show we did from the Pioneer Days or whatever they called the thing?
Western Fair.
We were looking for some kid to go and get us some ice cream cones or something, and he was the kid, so anyway.
And I never felt so honored because growing up in London, it was small C conservative, and there was only rock and roll music on CFPL for maybe 2.5 hours a night, and you'll remember this, Paul. And one day, and CHLO came on, and it was, there was a guy named Jim Brady who was on in the evening from 8 to midnight. And so you'd listen to it, and one night I left the radio on, and turned it on, left it on CHLO, and I wake up the next morning, and it's live, and it's rock and roll, and it's excitement and its energy. And I get a call from a friend of mine about an hour later, and he says, did you? And I said, I know, I've been listening to it all day. And that changed everything for me about what I really wanted to do. So then I go to the Western Fair, have to go to the CHLO thing because they're all there. J. Robert, Paul's there, Hal Weaver, Chuck, you were there, I think. And it was just like magic. Like this thing just brought life to my life. And after that, I heard that Bob went to CHUM, and I had moved on from, I'd gotten into radio by that point, and I moved on to Hamilton, and I could get CHUM all day long, and I worked 6 to midnight in Hamilton, and I used to listen to CHUM all day long, and I wanted to be there. And one day the program director said to me, what do you want to do? I said, well, eventually I want to go work at CHUM. Well, 3 weeks later, I had an interview at CHUM, and Bob called me and hired me, and I was just blown away by the intensity of doing it right. Not because you had to, but because you wanted to. He wanted you to be better than you were. He wanted you to be better than you thought you could possibly be. And he inspired me, and he inspired all of us, all the stories that have been told today. And it was just an honor to be there. And I was an operator, and as Warren said, you don't last more than 2 years in that job. So when CFUN was purchased, I went to Vancouver with Chuck and John Rohde and learned to do a few things there. And then I came back and worked in Toronto again. And it was the high point of my life as far as working with probably one of the best teams ever. And I've done some really fun things, some really incredible things, but I always go back to the time at CHUM as being the start of it all, of learning how to be really good even when you didn't feel like it, learning how to be good in spite of all the problems that we had, and in spite of yourself sometimes. You just wanted to be good because that was the culture that Bob Wood had created. And I forget who mentioned it, might have been John Tucker, said that he could rip you a new one and you still felt like you'd done a good job. And the one night I was working with Rivers. I worked with Chuck and I worked with Rivers. We were working Saturday night one night, something neither one of us wanted to do. And it was the night after Bob had sent out a memo about not eating on the air. Howard, you remember this. And you remember Rooney's around the corner, what passed as fine dining in those days. So River gets on the phone and he said, are you hungry? I said, no, I'm not, I'm fine. He said, this memo really pisses me off. I said, why am I not surprised? And those of you who know Rivers, the last thing you want to do is tell him what he can't do. So he gets on the phone and he calls Rooney's and he orders a 7-course dinner, which he has wheeled into the studio. And I thought, this is not going to end well. I just know this is not going to end well. So sure enough, Bob comes through the door, looks at Rivers. He says, what's this? Rivers said, I was hungry. So Bob just shook his head and turned around and walked out. I mean, it's all you could do. Anyway, it's been an honor for me to be associated with Bob all these years, to learn from him, and to consider him a friend, and to be associated with this great team and all the people who were part of this team that couldn't be here today. But thank you. I appreciate it.
Bill is the amateur psychologist we hired to look after Rivers. Yeah. And if I had been able to join him at the hip with Rivers, we'd still have Rivers working for us. I'd like to introduce the next guy who probably is known to most of you. He rose to the most senior levels in our business, Paul Ski. Paul was the afternoon DJ at CHLO in St. Thomas when I was there. And we had a great team there, really terrific on-air talent. And I suppose I should mention, first of all, that what most or many of you probably don't know, because you weren't necessarily in radio at that time, but in those days, the disc jockeys were gods. I kid you not. They were bigger than the artists in the music. The disc jockeys were gods. And the music business itself was bigger than Hollywood. And radio, especially top 40 radio, and stations like CHUM, were the center of the universe. We were the center of the culture. We shaped the culture. We were the culture. And so that's why in those days we all have such fond memories of it, because it was such a big deal in those days. So I arrive at CHLO in St. Thomas. We revamp the radio station and have a new lineup of jocks. We have Hal Weaver, just a fall-down funny guy who was doing midday. Paul Ski doing afternoon drive. Chuck McCoy doing evenings. We had probably Canada's first female DJ doing the all-night show, Arlene D, and Rick Smith later. Just a great little station. And one day, as we're rolling, I mean, we're having a big impact in London, Ontario. I mean, big. And so one day I go to Paul Ski's in the side booth where the copy department is, and I said something to Paul about, I need you to work tomorrow at so-and-so. And he said, I can't. And I said, why is that? And he said, because he said, I've got extra homework from my history teacher tonight, so he said, I can't do it. Paul was only about 15 or 16 or 17, working on the air at the station and doing a heck of a great job as the afternoon guy. And he had a telephone bit that was always very funny that he did every day. And my landlady, where Chuck and I stayed, Mrs. Murphy. Yeah, she used to never miss that feature. She loved it. And in any event, Paul is, you know, one of the heroes in my radio history who went on to bigger and better things. He's a great guy. And so I introduce you to Paul Skeet.
That's a tough introduction to follow, and tough to follow Chuck as well. I was trying to remember what year Bob came to CHLO, and I don't remember what 66. And as he said, I was 8 or 9 years old, doing afternoon drive. Okay, a little older than that. Doing afternoon drive, and the thing that was interesting for me is that I think for anybody, people who make an impact on you early in your career make a huge difference in what happens later in your career. I mean, you develop good habits, you learn good things about radio, you learn formatics, which Bob was a master at. Those are the things I learned. I mean, when he went to CHUM, I followed him into the program director's position at CHLO. But as he said, I was doing afternoon drive at the time, and that was the only real top 40 show on that radio station on CHLO, which was a 1,000 watt flamethrower in southwestern Ontario that got into Cleveland, Detroit, I mean, all over the place. It was fantastic. Later bought by Ted Rogers so he could expand 680, which is an interesting story, and CHLO moved to 1570, which was the first part of its decline, unfortunately. So I was doing afternoon drive, and Dick Williams was on CFPL doing an evening show, and he was the big top 40 jock at the time, and you knew that because when I would do a remote at Safeway, somebody would drive me there, and he'd be driving up in his Jag, right? So I was so happy when Bob eventually came to town, because then the station changed to Top 40 24/7. So, and those of you who have been on the air and been a PD at the same time know how difficult that was. And I think for Bob, Bob was doing mornings, as he said. Hal Weaver was doing middays. I was doing afternoon drive, and Chuck was doing evenings. And it was very interesting because luckily it was my hometown, and I had a pretty good following. The unfortunate thing is that the ratings after my show didn't fare quite as well when Chuck came on the air. And I don't want to say it was Chuck's fault, but I mean, I think somebody should be able to hold the audience over between like my show and Back to the Bible and his show. It was a mere half hour interlude of Back to the Bible, which followed my show, and yet he had a hard time bringing them back. I don't know what that was. But anyway, those were some fun days. At that time, John Moore owned the radio station at that time, and we didn't have a lot of money to do anything. And Bob was so ingenious, quite frankly. He developed something which was great. Chuck talked about the record hops. Well, we were doing record hops, and he worked out a deal with John Moore so that we could go out and do these record hops. And at that time, we just went out. We had it down to a science, actually. It wasn't just one a night. They'd be appearances that we'd make. So you'd make an appearance, collect the money, move on to the next one. As long as it was in close proximity, you could do really well on a weekend of record hops. You didn't have to stay there. You shook some hands, said hello to the people. Hi, where are you? Here's where I'm from. So, and I think we made from those about $200 a night. So, but we were able to promote them on the air, and the station didn't take any of the money for the promotion of those record hops. So Bob's deal was we kept half the money, and the other half went into something called the Jock Fund. And out of the Jock Fund, Bob did a couple of things. One, he bought Pam's jingles. He hired Bob Green, I guess, at WKNR in Detroit to do a bunch of imaging stuff for us. Yeah,
I'm done, I think. And I think part of it was, Bob, I think you paid that before, maybe we didn't have the jock fund when you were going to move, but paid for Hal Weaver's move and paid for those kind of things, which unfortunately, and not that John Moore was, okay, maybe he was, but we needed to find the money to do this. Bob found the way to get the money to do the things we needed to do to make that station so successful as it was at the time, as I say, early on in my career. The other thing I have to be thankful for from Bob, too, is that, and I wouldn't have been able to achieve what I've been able to achieve in broadcasting without him, is that I left CHLO. I wanted a program. I had programmed at CHLO. I thought it was maybe time to move on, so I moved to Sudbury and was programming a couple of radio stations in Sudbury for a very interesting gentleman up there, Ralph Connor. And I guess Bob at the time, who was at CHUM, had heard what I was doing there, and he and Fred Sherratt, I guess, listened to the station and thought, okay, it sounds okay, so maybe Paul could program CFRA in Ottawa. And so Bob and Fred hired me to program CFRA. We did fairly well there, but that was when I joined CHUM. Was at CFRA in Ottawa, and then, of course, moved along from there, from Halifax to Vancouver to eventually to Toronto. But if it hadn't have been for Bob, in the early years, to develop the great skill set that I was able to develop through his tutorship during that time, and then to, I don't want to say bail me out of Sudbury, but move me on to what would be the next step in my career, is something that I'll be internally grateful for. So, Bob, thanks very much.
Just one comment I'd like to make that Chuck and Paul might not remember, but it sticks out of my mind. At CHLO, with this jock fund, we were able to do a lot of different things that would help to further the station. And one of the things we did was to subscribe to a U.S. record service so that we would get the records faster than anybody else, Ted Randall's service. So we would get these new records and be on the air saying another CHLO world premiere. And that was part of the magic that helped us to advance past CFPL in London. Within 90 days, we became the number one station in London. And we used to go on the air in those days because we had such a low commercial load. And we had kids working on this for us. And they would count how many records Dick Williams would play on his show and how many we would play. And then we would have the CHLO music monitor, I think it was. This hour, CFPL. Or I'm sorry, this hour, CHLO, 17 records. CFPL, 9 records. And the other thing we used to do is go on the air, because there were no rules saying we could do whatever we wanted. We'd go on the air and say, and we play one of these world premieres. And when the record was about to start playing, we'd say, now, here's the latest song from the Rolling Stones. Call Dick Williams and ask him how many weeks it's going to be before he'll play it for you. Yeah.
Bob, I wonder if you had any tapes of your household finance commercials.
You mean my Joel Aldred commercials?
Do you remember those commercials, those household finance?
I don't.
Bob would do the household finance commercials a lot. You remember these. Yeah. And he would actually say, now, this is a great company if you want to borrow money. Now, if you don't pay them back, they come to your door.
I don't remember that.
Every morning.
The interesting, when you think about it, it seems kind of simplistic to just be buying that music service from Ted Randall. But up until that time, we were taping those songs off of U.S. radio stations that had them. And the quality, obviously, was not the best. We may have been the first to play them, but until we got that service, we didn't really have the quality of those songs. But we were still first.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, and one quick follow-up on that. When we... we were playing the records like every 4 hours or something like that and burning them up pretty quickly. So I used to be driving the record companies to send us more copies. And one day, Jack Feeney, who was at RCA, got really ticked at this, and he called John Moore. And he said, what is all of this business about you need more copies of the records? If you need more copies of the records, you can pay for them. Go and buy your own. So John Moore came to me and told me what was going on. And I said, okay, Mr. Moore, I'll look after it, no problem. So we paid for RCA records, I think from our jock fund, so that we would have the extra copies that we needed. But we never once put an RCA record on the chart. And suddenly, they started to figure it out. If they weren't on the chart, they weren't going to sell any records. So that's when they started sending us records. Anyway, I'd like to think I've almost covered most of the people at this end of the room. That have I missed anybody here? Okay, so Jean, you're next. Come on. Jean, by the way, is the lady who worked at the station in the reception and switchboard for in the early years, and she's been sort of a big radio fan for a long time, attends some of the Charlie Rittenberg radio get-togethers, and she's just one of the family.
Well, as a little girl, I used to love CHUM, and I entered the Purple People Eater contest in 1958, and I didn't get a prize. And when I moved to Toronto, I thought, well, just for Hillary, I'll come and apply for a job. And Lynn Rice came down, and she said, when can you start? So I said, well, 2 weeks. And she said, could you start tomorrow? And I said, no. I couldn't believe this. I was going to work for CHUM. And for the next 3 years, it was just an absolute whirlwind, and there was never a dull moment, and every single day was not like work. And the only funny story that I can really repeat, because everything was so unpolitically correct back then, is I guess one day Marvin Starr came in, and he said, Hal Weaver, what time is Hal Weaver off the air? He said, I need to collect a debt. And I thought, oh, crap, you know, poor Hal, you know, this guy. So I said, well, he's off the air at such and such a time. So in the meantime, I went around the block, around to the studio, and I said, Hal, you're in deep doo-doo. I said, Marvin Starr is sitting out there, and he's going to get you. So meanwhile, Hal said, oh, yeah, that's great. So he digged out the back door, and poor Marvin Starr was sitting there for about an hour, and they couldn't find Hal anywhere. But anyway, I never really did feel that bad about it, because he was kind of a good guy.
Yeah.
But anyway, so that's my story. But anyway, and
Doug, did you want to finish off that Marvin Starr story?
I'm not sure if, okay, there's a couple actually, but Marvin Starr eventually did come back into the station again, and Mr. Waters and Bob had to have a meeting with Hal and Marvin Starr, and he wanted his car back. He wanted the money.
Yeah, Marvin was a car dealer. Tell them that.
Oh, sorry, Marvin Starr was a car dealer, sorry. Yeah, Marvin Starr was a car dealer. He wanted his car back or the money for the car. So Hal gets out his checkbook and starts writing checks, which bounce. He never did it, but there's another one about that. David Haydu is a very famous engineer at CHUM, yeah. And he's known as Geets Romo, too, as well. Now, he was an engineer at CHUM at the time, not a board op, but an actual engineer who fixed things. And he was in my production studio one day, and Hal Weaver just came rushing in and said, I need to borrow somebody's car real quick. Give me, who's got keys? And Dave had the keys to his car, so he gave them to Hal. This was maybe 11 o'clock in the morning. About 5 o'clock, Dave's ready to go home, and Hal's not around. So he goes to the switchboard and said, have you seen Hal Weaver? Yeah, he just went on a 2-week vacation. In Geets' car. Yeah. Crazy. That's the kind of people we had, though. Those are the crazy people that make radio great. And Bob hired them all.
Thank you, Doug. Yeah, one day the Bell telephone guy came into the studio because we had to have some work done on the phones. Hal was on the air. Hal hit him up for $200. Guy came back, and the guy loved Hal. The guy came back the next day, and he said, well, where's Hal? And I said, he's gone away for a week. He's on vacation. I don't think that guy ever got the money.
You can be sure of it.
That's right. Yeah. I want to interrupt part of the plan here. I wanted to get to some of the ladies, and I will, but I want Mr. Hennessy here to make a comment, if he would. So, Roy, you can stand up, and I know you're not one of the CHUM group, but you're a grumpy old man, and we know we want to give you a chance to talk.
A member of the club?
Yes.
Ah, well, boy. No, I'm not a former CHUM, but I've been associated in many ways with CHUM for years. But a couple of things that you mentioned, the thing with the records and using Randall's Music Service. Well, CFUN had Randall's Music Service in Vancouver, so I got Betty Brennerman, who was the music director at KHJ, and her husband, Tom. We put him into the business of doing the same thing. So we would, now it was a race between the airlines, who could get the package in first Monday morning to get our brand new virgin copies of US 45s. And then, of course, the Canadian 45s would arrive, and Quality did the pressing, and they sucked. They had no punch, no fidelity. Actually, they put out a Wilson Pickett record. I remember they put it, I can't remember which one it was. There was a Wilson Pickett 45 arrived, and they'd been so conscientious in pressing it, they left out the voice track. Nothing serious, just, you know. But the other thing we used to do for when it was battle between CFUN and LG, we'd get an exclusive, let's say, LG exclusive. We'd dub it onto cart with a voice track over it, right? So we'd, we found out they were taping us to get the singles that we got first. So we started voicing LG exclusive over top of it. But there was a young lady who lived in the West End who was a flight attendant for an airline that I ran into at some point. And she had a friend who happened to be a pilot who was going to England when the Beatles, they were about to release, I forget which album it was, but the British version of the album had Yesterday on it. The Canadian Capitol version didn't. They dropped out two cuts off the album, and she got him to fly the album back. And I met him at the airport, took the album back, and suddenly we were playing Yesterday when no one else had it, with the LG exclusive over it, you know, and of course LG's or CFUN's monitoring KJR for when they get, they couldn't get it either because it was out of England. But those kind of battles and wars were just skullduggery, you know. Just there's one, Red Robinson, who is a Hall of Fame disc jockey in Vancouver, wrote a book, and there's a few things in there that are great. One of them was when the Stones played Vancouver for the first time, they arrived at the airport, and of course, high intense security, they arrived at the airport, and a couple of limos pulled up to pick up the Stones, and they dropped the gates, the doors open, the Stones walk in, walk down, get in the cars, and head off downtown. This was a CFUN Presents. And on the air, I think Russ Simpson was still doing afternoon drive then. Simpson's talking about, stand by, we're going to have an exclusive interview with the Rolling Stones in their limousine coming up. And well, nobody checked the ID of the drivers of the limos. Nobody checked it. So we had a couple of limos, and they pulled up, and the Stones jumped in. And was, hey, Mick, how you doing? We're LG. Welcome to Vancouver. I guess I'm okay. I'm fine. I'm good, you know. And we literally stole the Stones and had them on the air. It was brutal.
Brilliant.
That's what you got into the business for, right? That kind of thing. And this mentioned briefly in the video, when I first got to know Bob, outside of being that evil Eastern dude from those CFUN guys and the CHUM group, that sort of thing, was when they were about to bring in the Canadian content regulations, which all of us, I was music director then of LG, and all of us were 100% behind. Yeah, let's regulate. That's what we need, you know, so we can play more. What? Anyway, you know the issues we were going through then. And Bob called a group of us. I think there were about 10 altogether. It was Dave Charles, Bob Robertson in Calgary, myself, Keith James. Yeah, Keith, myself.
Nevin Grant
in Hamilton. He
Frank
called
someone in Montreal. Frank, I forget his last name, in Montreal.
Anyway, he called, and at a conference call, oh, this is really new stuff. A conference call from Toronto, you know? And the conversation was, what could we do as a group that would impress the BBG to not proceed with this bureaucracy, and we were with the doom and gloom we thought was going to come forward out of that. What could we do? And the idea evolved, driven by JR, that we would create the Maple Leaf system, where we would have a conference call every week. We would all receive half a dozen, 10 records that week. We would all listen to them, see how they might fit, where we could use them, and we would telex Bob with the ones that we liked and the ones we didn't. We'd have a conference. Yeah, Canadian records. Oh, yeah. Yeah, just concentrating on the Canadian records. And that we would all pick, how many did we pick? One, two?
Two, I think.
Two or three.
Two or three. But we agreed that we would give them the same exposure that we would give any other new releases, wherever they came from. They would go in the same kind of rotation, same exposure, and we would track the results. And from that, at the end of each week, we'd report the results, talk about, yeah, that one by the guess who or whoever, that one's solid. And we'd all commit to go forward and give it more exposure, equal exposure, and then report the results to the trade magazine and keep track of it, and the sales, to see what kind of impact we could create. So we did that, and we came up with a logo, and we put the logo on our chart and said that we were part of the Maple Leaf system and promoted it on air, what we were doing. And we had some success. We traded chairing the meetings around every 6 months or every year. But it was my turn to chair the calls, so I got to do it early in the day out of Vancouver. And I remember we were listening to records that we thought might work, and we were also looking at album tracks, and we picked up one track that we thought might really do well. So we put it on across the group, the network, and we got response. And the next week we're on the phone call, and we're all saying, this is a hit. Yeah, but it's not a single. You can't chart an album. You know, what are we going to do? Well, we got to get a single. Well, let's call the record company. Well, who knows anybody at the record company? Well, a few of us knew the president of the record company, but he was on vacation in Hawaii. Well, because of the big budget we had, LG was closer to Hawaii than anybody else, so the long distance charge would be less, so you phone. I said, okay, I'll phone. So I called, we found out where he was, and we phoned in Maui. We called Dave Evans at Capitol Records, and we think the group of us, we've done our testing, whatever you want to call it, we think you should release this as a single. So we did. And out came Snowbird with Ann Murray. It worked.
Yeah, you're right.
But nobody, I mean, there was no credibility for it. And, well, let's just say it was a great idea. Anyway, that's when I first got to know Bob and work with him. And in the last 5 years, 6 years, we've become the closest friends, like you guys relate to him. I've become that way with him in the last 5 years, because he's joking about being a grumpy old man. There's a group of us, very small group, one who's no longer with us, and we used to meet quarterly to curvetch about the industry and what's going on, that kind of thing.
Our board meetings.
We call them our board meetings, and we used to just send emails, okay, to so-and-so, to Bill, who is a GOM. And anyway, we were sending these emails back and forth, and finally it was suggested, we can't keep, we've got to, we're a group. We actually are an organization. So it came up, we should be, I don't know who said it out, but somebody with a sick mind said,
you.
We are the grumpy old men. And it was instantaneous, we are. It was 3 hours later, we had a logo. We had t-shirts, right? I mean, it took nothing to turn this thing around. T-shirts, and we still meet quarterly. And I consider him one of my closest and dearest and most admired friends.
Thank you very much. Very nice to have you. Thank you. We booked this room until 7 o'clock, so we only have not quite 10 minutes left. So I'd like to hear from Mary Ann, and then I'm going to turn it over at great risk to my sister for a few minutes. No? No, not much. Okay, well, Mary Ann, and Debbie, would you like to say a few words?
No, I wasn't thinking. No?
Okay. So just to let you know, Mary Ann is the lady who did our traffic reports on CHUM and co-hosted the morning show with Jay Nelson and later Tom Rivers. And as I have said before and written before, she has such a quick mind that Jay Nelson used to get frustrated with her because she would often top him on their exchanges. Anyway, Mary Ann is probably the first woman to co-host a morning show in major market radio in Canada. And many of the women who followed in later years patterned themselves after Mary Ann.
Thank you, Bob. It's really nice to be here. I've worked with so many people in this room, not in the least Bob Wood, who gave me everything I have, as Larry McGinnis so aptly pointed out. I worked with Larry, who wrote comedy for Tom Rivers and I and the morning team. We did episode after episode of Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khorne.
This is Tom.
That was Rivers. Yes, that was Rivers. And Tomatoes of the Lost Ark. I got to play all the female parts, all of them. The guys would not do them. I tried to talk them into it, but no, they were far too macho for that. But it was really great to be with Jay Nelson and Tom Rivers and Mike Cooper and with John Tucker. All of you people brought me up in the business that made a career of more than 25 years for me. It was my seminal years at CHUM and the ones following that that kept me on a morning show for the rest of my broadcast life. And it was a brilliant career. And every day I was on the air, I thought of Bob. I took from his direction. It was an imprint that never left me and always served me well. And I'm so grateful for that. Now, let's cut the sappy part and talk about what it was like to be at Maple Leaf Gardens when the Stones did the Tour of the Americas after a four-year hiatus. And I got to go and cover it with a phone, a portable phone that was in a box about this big. What a party they had after that. And Bob had me on the phone with my head on the desk the next morning, begging to go away. Give us some more coverage. Call him up and cover it again for the second concert tonight. He was urging me onto this. I said, Bob, I've been up for 24 hours since the morning show started yesterday. I went to a party last night after the concert. I covered the show. Terry Steele simulcast it. When we had the phone up there in the golds, just above the door, when the tune would start up, Steele's in the cockpit, in the control room, would have that record ready to cue up immediately, and bang, the audience got a simulcast that was fake. But for those who didn't have tickets listening to CHUM, they got the show. And it was great fun. It was great fun. I never had so much fun in my life. Probably won't ever again. But I have great memories to rely on. Thank you, everyone.
I guess we're just about out of time. Is there anybody else? Howard, would you like to say a few words? And just so you know, ladies and gentlemen, Howard used to work in the CHUM News Department, and he went on after his career to set up Broadcast Dialogue, which is the Canadian newsletter for radio, and it has been for many years, with his wife Ingrid. They cover what's happening in the business, keeps us all together, and it's the most read publication for radio people every week when it comes out, I think on Thursdays. And it's Howard and his wife who have run this for many years.
I don't have anything to say about Jay Robert because I didn't really work with him or speak with him at all. But I did have a lot of friends on the on-air staff at CHUM. Tom, of course, was a real buddy. And Maz was part of our little group as well. And Billy Anderson was part of it as well. And we were bad buggers. But I remember being in there on a weekend, and Tom was doing a weekend shift. We were talking about Canadian talent a moment ago. Tom despised a lot of Canadian talent, particularly Gino Vannelli. And shut up. And I was there one Saturday afternoon. Tom was working a shift, and I think it was Maz was on the board, I think. But I guess he talked to Maz before I got there. I was in the control room and listening to you with Maz for a second. And he introduced Gino Vannelli. I Just Want to Stop. The first reference to I Just Want to Stop, pull the pot down, 10:50, CHUM, more music. It was a hilarious moment. First reference, it was great, Mike. The I have a number of memories from CHUM back in those days, the frivolity in the station and out. But a real character at CHUM was Fred Ennis. Fred was the traffic reporter at this time, mornings and evenings. I was leaving the building. I worked at CHUM. I was leaving the building about 5:30 one evening, and Fred, between traffic reports, happened to be out in the little hallway before the front door, and Mr. Sherratt was just leaving the building. And it was always Mr. Waters, Mr. Sherratt. So Mr. Sherratt is walking to the front door, and Fred leans out through the little hallway door and he says, "Thanks for stopping by, Fred." The way Fred would do it. Speaking of Fred, as noted earlier, Fran's restaurant was the only place in town anywhere near CHUM that was open 24 hours a day. And Fred and I were in there one night about 2 in the morning, and there was a line up to the dining room off to the right, and of course the little area with the booze was all filled up. So we're in this long lineup. There's a young lady and a gentleman with her in front of us, and of course there's the sound of a room. People are chatting, everyone's chatting, and at one point the room just kind of naturally quieted when the fella who had never been in France before said to the girl, "Is this place open 24 hours a day?" And Fred pipes up and says, "Yes, it is. Makes you wonder how they clean the joint, doesn't it?" And my last Fred story, a real quick one. Ports of Call, the Last Chance Saloon. We're sitting there, about 3 scotches in. Waitress is near closing time. The waitress came over, and she said, "Anything else?" And Fred says, "Yes, I've got a question." And he says, "What's that?" And he says, "How fast was that bear going when it hit the wall?" And that's it. That's what I've got for you today.
Thank you very much, sir.
Mm.
Okay, unless, well, we're actually out of time now for this room. Somebody else has booked the room from here. Anybody who wishes to stay, if you want to order dinner or whatever, they're keeping the tables at this end of the restaurant open for anybody that wants to stay. And in the meantime, I really want to thank everybody for coming out and getting together for this great event. And I will do the follow-up with you for both the ad that features all of your names, and don't forget the FYI article that, if it isn't in there today, it'll be in next week, to make sure that you get the credit that you deserve for creating one of broadcasting's great radio stations. I rode there today on your shoulders, and it's because you are the ones who made it happen. And so it's our award, and I'll show it to you once they finish the engraving on the back. So thanks for coming.
We built this city. This is Dick Smyth, CHUM Contemporary News. And now from Toronto, more music with Jay Nelson.
1050 CHUM.
Morning, welcome into the Jay Nelson Show. It's 8 minutes after 7 o'clock. My wife got a brand new pair of Italian shoes Saturday. We know they're Italian because they pinch her.
Well, Marianne, I tell you, people are calling. They don't believe I've got a chicken in the studio with
me. There sure is a chicken in your studio.
There certainly is. How do you turn that chicken off?
I don't know.
Tell it you're married.
All right. All right now. Traffic. Those construction sites are already delaying traffic southbound on Yonge at Fairlawn and on Mount Pleasant just south of the Eglinton Lights.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to John Rohde.
1050 CHUM Toronto.
Been a big arrest in Nashville, Tennessee at the Premium Meatpacking Company. It seems though the police discovered 9 or 10 of the employees there smoking ham. Didn't seem natural or something. Here's Norman Greenbaum on CHUM.
Johnny Mitchell, 1050 CHUM.
Here's a young lady called Nino Tempo, and her brother April Stevens, the other way around, I think. Anyway, she used to sing with the big bands back in the 40s, as you might remember. Her and her brother got together and made some rock and roll music in 1963 called Deep Purple, Nice Song.
J. Michael Wilson, 1050 CHUM.
Squeak, I just had a call, Michael, from an authentic Canadian cowboy.
Who was that, Rodney, huh?
Well, I didn't catch his name, but he is the foreman on a big cattle ranch down near Orangeville.
Oh, which ranch?
It's a place called the ABC Lazy Q Double Diamond Circle Bar X Triangle P Double Ot Ranch.
How many cattle he got?
They only got 3, Michael.
How come only 3?
Well, he says not many of them survive the branding.
Uh-huh.
More music, 1050 CHUM.
9:17. Tom Rivers is on CHUM's Million Dollar Weekend. I'm challenging anybody to play more music than I do. Can they do it?
No.
And more hits just keep on coming.
1050 CHUM, CHUM Toronto.
Hello, lover. It's 9 o'clock from CHUM. And the check turned up on a Thursday night exclusively to turn you on. Don't leave me now. Can't do without you. I dig you.
I'm taking a shave.
1228 from Canada's music leader. This is Roger Ashby. Sunday afternoon, Shredney Vashtar's jump is coming up in a matter of minutes. Evel Knievel makes his jump at 5:30. Ceremonies or whatever you want to call it get underway at 4 at Maple Leaf Gardens. Steppenwolf and a straight shooting lady.
CHUM, the best music, the best station. It's 3:30 with Dave Williams.
1050 CHUM, Toronto.
Anybody see the debates last night? Boring! Has the same effect on people as a Valium. 1206, Mike Cooper with the Andrea True Connection.
Your main music station. You got it, baby. CHUM, Pat Riley's in the seat. It's 9:03, and the superstars are right here, man. We've got them in person. We've got the tickets so you can see them in concert. Bay City Rollers coming Tuesday, right? Or is that Wednesday? Pretty close. We got him on record. Here's Lou Rawls. Look out.
CHUM. It's kind of appropriate, huh? Get the theme going, you know, make it flow. Just picture yourself surfing with the music, man. You're riding the crest of the wave right now. Oh, yeah. Right? We made that one. Let's go for another one now at 6:24. The most music time. Duke Roberts show. These are the spinners. Could it be? I'm falling in love. With love. Here it comes.
Shoulders back, I got my chest out, got my shoes off, I'm ready to do some partying right now on the Rock of Toronto, CHUM. John Major here with 53 minutes of music this hour.
1050 CHUM.
Hi, 1215 at your music station, CHUM. And this is Terry Steele. After this weekend, I think the weatherman got confused when he was back in university with cold fronts, warm fronts, and tavern fronts. Second week in a row, he really missed. Completely. It's been nice. I play this because I love you, baby. It's the best way I can say it. Silly little love songs from Wings at the Speed of Sound. Paul McCartney.
This is CHUM News at 9. I'm John Belmont. It's 20 degrees at CHUM.
The best music. 1050 CHUM.
Say now, look at that. 902. In the magical kingdom of boogie, you guys got covered inside your radio. Not only that, but you also got chances for yourself to win a pair of tickets to see the Stones, a Calhoun Rolling Stones t-shirt, and a copy of the latest Rolling All Stones LP. In moments, here's BTO.
Oh, that's okay. Everything's running a little slow today. 8:02 at CHUM in Toronto. This is Bob McGee. I know it's tough out there. Has been all day. And the buses are still not running. But look on the bright side. At least you won't get stuck behind one of those smelly things tonight.
Good morning, Toronto. It's 12:10. I'm your CHUM. This is Jim Van Horn with your rock and roll. Elton John is here with Crocodile Rock. It's 1:30 in the Superstar Summer. This is Steve Elliott doing it for you.
10:50 CHUM, Toronto.
Oh, yes. 7:04. This is Daryl May and CHUM with up to 50 minutes of music this hour. I tell you, even if you're horizontal, there is hope for you. Because I got the good stuff, baby. I mean, good. Spinners, rubber band man.
10:50 CHUM, Toronto. 5:09, the encore hour of the Steve Bolton Show. Got some old rock and roll coming up from Chuck Berry this hour. Stick around for it.
CHUM 1050 Toronto.
Request line number 870-9111. Call me right now. We're going to be doing requests and dedications for the rest of the evening till 12 midnight. Gene McDaniels, Hot CHUM. Song about him. Yes, indeed. He just took 100 pounds of clay and he got a hernia, you understand what I mean? But look what he created, my gracious.
He took 100 pounds of clay and then he said, hey, listen, I'm gonna fix this world today because I know what's missing. Then he rolled his big sleeves up.
CHUM 1050 Toronto.